Greetings and welcome. We are in Junior English, and our objective now for the hour is to introduce you to one of the most remarkable poets in the American literary tradition. It's my hope that you have your hymnal open to page 404, 405, 406, 407. That's where we'll be working now in our introductory comments. And in these series of comments, I'm only going to be working with an introduction to Emily Dickinson. And then as well, you should have a little handout maybe appropriated to you where I have two of Emily Dickinson's poems that are not in this anthology but are very famous poems of Dickinson. If you're watching online, you can always find these two poems rather easily by Googling the first line. Let's talk Emily Dickinson for a moment. Dickinson is going to be amazing on two counts, and you want to write these down. You want to write these down. We're going to talk about Emily Dickinson as person and Emily Dickinson as poet. Okay, so you want to write that down. Emily Dickinson as person is a remarkable story. Emily Dickinson as poet is an even more remarkable story. But are you ready for this? We're going to ultimately see you don't appreciate this poet until you take Emily Dickinson as person and Emily Dickinson as poet and you put them together. Her story is going to inform much of her poetry, okay? And will help you to be able to read her poetry, which, let's just point out, is not always an easy project, okay? It's not always an easy project. Let's begin, first of all, with dates. They are right there for you, 1830 to 1886. So roughly you can say 1850 if you need a round date. I like round dates to just kind of remember stuff. So 1850 is a good round date for Emily Dickinson, okay? Now, what are we going to say about this woman? Well, she is a remarkable story of a person. From what we can gather, she lived two lives, for your notes, two lives. The first life is the life before the age of 30 that apparently was fairly social and active. Now, she was born into, as you can see that picture on 404 there, she was born into a family of some financial means, okay? And Emily Dickinson then spent much of her early years in and around this area where this house was. Amherst, Massachusetts is where she's from. Pretty remarkable to note that Emerson, Thoreau, Dickinson all come from this Massachusetts, Boston, Amherst, Concord area. Lots of things happening during this time of the 1800s or so, okay? But then, are you ready for this? About 30, for reasons that are still discussed today, Dickinson began to become reclusive. Reclusive. She didn't like going out in public very much. Some have used even the term agoraphobic for this person. Agoraphobic of a related phobia, fear. Agoraphobic, agora was the Greek term for the marketplace or the mall. To be agoraphobic means you don't like to go out in public anymore. Maybe you've known somebody like this who, hey dude, we're going on a trip to, no, I ain't going. Hey, come on, we'll go to the ball game. No, I wouldn't go. They prefer to just stay inside, maybe sit in their house and not go out in public. That is what we mean by reclusive. Emily, by the end of her life, can go for long periods of time and see absolutely nobody but maybe her close family members. There are parties, for example, at the house, at the Dickinson house, and people will sometimes at the party see her come out the door, go back in the door, that kind of thing. And they're like, oh, it's Emily. And over time, it's just kind of accepted that Emily Dickinson is a little bit different. Leave her alone. Her dad took very good care of her. He's kind of fond of her. And he said, don't worry about it. I'll build you a nice little garden in the backyard, and you can spend time there all alone. It's not a worry. Now, people knew that Emily was doing some writing. Okay? They just didn't know really the extent of the writing that she was doing. In her lifetime, are you ready for this? She did not publish hardly anything. She shared periodically once or twice some of her poems in a letter or something like that, try and publish something, but did not publish very much. And then in 1886, she dies. And they go into her room. And in her room, they find on little scraps of paper stuff she's written. And they're all bundled up. If you look on page 404, you will even see that this little bundling is given a term. Okay? Fasciles. F-A-S-C-I-C-L-E-S. Do you see it on page 404 under Dickinson's legacy? They're all bundled up in little bows and stuff like that. And at first they don't know what they are because you can't read her handwriting. And they get ready to throw this stuff all away. Now she had declared, whatever she wrote, please destroy. But they started reading this stuff and they're like, whoa, this is like poetry and stuff she wrote. They don't destroy it. And initially it is published, but published poorly. Nobody knows what to do with this stuff. Do you call it poems? None of it's titled. It's written on little scraps of paper, for example. The outside of an envelope. A little bit of a scrap of newspaper. Things like that. There's her little writing table. You can see it, 405, her little writing table where she sat. And she did a lot of this stuff. Well, it's not going to be, and now I'm on 405. It's not going to be until 1955. Boy, oh boy, is that an important date for us. And those of us who love poetry, we are so grateful for 1955's edition called the Johnson Edition, okay? Thomas H. Johnson in 1955 compiles all these poems. Are you ready for this? Over 1,000 poems she writes in her lifetime. And nobody knew. Nobody knew. She wasn't publishing this stuff. Nobody called her a famous poet. Nobody called her a famous writer. See, by the time Emerson and Thoreau die, for example, everybody knows they are major guns. Nobody knows this for Emily Dickinson. And it takes from, notice her dates, 1886 to 1855. Dude, almost 100 years later, before she finally is, quote unquote, discovered. And people start reading her stuff in the 1950s and 60s and go, whoa, wait a minute. This woman was doing stuff way ahead of her time. And today, are you ready for this? She's considered one of the five greatest American poets of all time. Isn't that wild? She never published much in her lifetime, was not known as a great poet, and today, of all of the tens of thousands of people who we call American poets, she's in the top five. Remarkable, right? Remarkable story. Now, when we look at Emily Dickinson's stuff, right, and of course this last heading on 405, The Belle of Amherst, Dickinson is such an enigma. Do you know that term? An enigmatic character, an enigma, means a puzzle. We don't know a lot about her because she didn't say anything about herself. Really, the only thing she ever said about herself is the stuff she left in her writing, and as you're about to find out, well, I told you, Dickinson is known as poet, as person, as well as poet. When we look at her poetry, we're going to say, boy, there's a lot of stuff we can kind of understand about her, but we have to guess at a lot of it, because Dickinson was kind of a enigma. She was a puzzle. Now, for all of us who are high school students, who like to be maybe a little bit outside of the norm, outside of the community of the school, we don't like to be all the, we're not one of the populars, if you get my drift. Okay, we're not one of those people. We let those people do their thing, and we go and we do our thing. This is maybe the one writer in the junior tradition of junior English that you're going to appreciate as being a poet and a person that you can kind of maybe identify with. Here she is, all alone. For example, look at the poem that I've given to you. It's not in your book, and that's kind of sad to me that it's not. Because if any time I introduce Emily Dickinson, I like to introduce her first with this poem. Often in anthologies, this is one of the first poems that's given. Take a look at it. This, are you reading with me? You're now just looking at your sheet of paper, because this isn't in your book. This is my letter to the world that never wrote to me. Whoa! She sees her poems as a letter to the world, a world that she never connected with. The world never wrote to her. This is my letter to the world that never wrote to me. Notice the dash. the simple news that nature told, notice nature is capitalized, with tender majesty. Let's go ahead and here we're annotating on this page as we go. So you're just actually doing it level one right now in the right hand margin next to the poem. You're writing stuff down as we work through this poem. What's the first two lines? This is my letter to the world that never wrote to me. This is my attempt to try to touch the world, because the world never touched me back. For the last years of her life, she lived as a recluse. Notice the second thing. My poetry is simple, simple news, and we'll circle that word simple and we'll put a big question mark there and a smiley face, because one of the things about Emily Dickinson as poet is that always we're going to look at these little poems, notice my adjective little, they're always short, they're always little. When Johnson published these poems, and then people afterwards, they call the poems often, the title was always just the first line, because Dickinson didn't name any of these poems, right? Notice she says it's simple, and then she says nature told it to her. Now this is important. Dickinson is a great poet of nature. So in that regard, she's often going to fit right in with transcendentalists. So notice, in our anthology, they will put Emily Dickinson right next to Emerson and Thoreau. In other words, they call her almost like a transcendental poet. Remember, transcendentalists love that. Remember our two boxes on the board where you can have Ruthie's tree in the first box, and then in the second box you have the word nature. You might call Ruthie's tree nature with a small n, and then the word nature, or the concept nature, with a capital N. Notice she capitalizes the word nature. In other words, this is going to be Emily Dickinson's tipping of her hat to transcendentalism and say, my poetry is not only about the stuff in the first box, Ruthie's tree, but it's also stuff about the second box, nature. And notice, nature shared with me the simple message or the simple news with tender majesty. And the word tender is an interesting word. Soft. Gentle. And Dickinson will be this way as well. You can kind of imagine, or I mean, you can see pictures of her there on 404 and 406. She has a tender face, doesn't she, on 406. You can kind of see. We will call her maybe the enigma of tenderness, right? And yet, she is going to have tremendous power, majesty, in her poetry. Notice what she says about nature. Her message is committed. As well, her can be talking about Emily Dickinson herself. To hands I cannot see. Now this is fascinating. Follow this. This is a woman who writes over 1,000 poems, dies, says to the people left behind, kill all my stuff, burn it, burn all my stuff. And yet in one of her poems she says, I'm writing to you. Now, it's almost like she's saying to you, hey, you, reading my stuff right now, you're handling my poem, but I can't see that you're, I can't see who you are. But I hope what? Take a look. For love of her, nature, sweet. Notice it works with tender. Countrymen, Americans, readers of my stuff. Judge tenderly of me. The word tender gets used twice in this poem. She asks you to do something. Now this is fascinating. It's why this poem is often rendered as the first poem in, her, in any collection of her poetry. I'm gonna share my stuff with you. But I hope that you will judge tenderly of me. Jot down what you think that means at level one. What does that mean to you? Judge tenderly of me. And if you've ever created anything, if you've ever produced anything, as a little kid, you can even remember this. You remember? And you did something and you wanted to show it to somebody. Your hope was that the look on their face would be a happy one and not a sad one. Dickinson is aware that when she shares her stuff with you, you may have a tendency initially to go, what? Dude, this is crap. I don't even understand what you're talking, right? And so she asks you, even though she was agoraphobic and didn't spend any time around people, she assumed maybe someday her stuff would get read. And when it was ready, if it was read, she asked, would you just be nice to me? Be tender to me. Which is interesting. So she's going to ask you to deal with her gently. Don't draw conclusions too early, she's saying. Just chill and follow what I'm trying to do. Well, what is she trying to do? Well, that's a good question. And now we'll turn over to page 406, 407. We're really going to camp more on 407 for a few moments. What is she trying to do? Well, her project is prodigious. You like that adjective? Prodigious. That is to say, she's going everywhere. This woman is amazing for all the stuff she'll try to do in her poetry. Let's talk about Dickinson as poet. There's two things that make Dickinson as poet, and now you're taking notes about Dickinson as poet. There's two things about Dickinson as poet that's quite fascinating, quite powerful. First, we're going to talk about form. Second, we're going to talk about content. Okay? And when we look at poetry in general, but certainly the work of Dickinson, we want to pay attention to both of these facets. Dickinson's poems in terms of form, literally the way they look on the page. Okay? And then secondly, content. In other words, what is it that she says? Let's start with form. When you look at Emily Dickinson's poems, and you can just start turning, and I suggest you do this with me now, you can just start turning. 408, 409, 411, 412, look at 413, right? Look how little that poem is, right? 414, okay, the soul selects her own society. Notice, about all these poems, look at 416, look at 417. What do you want to say right away about all these poems? They are what? Yeah, they're short, aren't they, right? So right away, we're going to say something about Dickinson's poetry. Uh-oh, you want to write this down, because this is the first and monumental mistake that student readers of her poem will make, and that is, dude, it's short, it must be E-A-S-Y, right? Dude, it's short. I can get this done in no time. I'll sit down and I'll read this in 30 seconds and I'll have it done. My homework, done. And then all of a sudden they start reading the poem and they go, whoa, whoa, whoa. What am I reading? Most of the vocabulary words I'm going to know. But I'm going to look at it and go, whoa, what am I reading? What is she saying? Let's say it this way. I like to say it this way in regards to the juxtaposition of form and content. Emily Dickinson's poetry is simply complex. Simply. Easy. Complex. Hard. That is to say, paradox. Now, I know you saw that word on 407 under literary analysis, and she loves this paradox stuff. What is paradox? Well, that's oxymoron or oxymoron. Hyperbole, sometimes it's recalled even. What does that mean? Two things that do not fit together so easy. Simply complex. Two things that just often don't quite go together so well. And it will be in this paradox that we will find the genius of this poet. Okay? Let's point out a couple of other things about Dickinson in regards to form, laying on the page. Simple language. She loves simple language. She also loves punctuation marks. Notice the last punctuation mark in This Is My Letter to the World is an exclamation point, which is funny because she uses the word tender twice, and then she uses an exclamation point, which tells you that in English language it's supposed to be with force, right? So she finishes the poem with force. Notice she likes the dash. You'll see her using the dash a lot. It's almost as if she wants you to pause for a second and then move on with an idea, like she's trying to break the idea up. She also likes to play the game of easy rhyme, slant rhyme. I'm with you on 407. We call it easy rhyme or exact rhyme, and slant rhyme. That is to say, exact rhyme. Now, what exactly do we mean by that? Well, just read with me on 407 under literary analysis. Poets use rhyme to stress, notice, any number of kinds of ideas, make their poems, of course, with rhythm, convey mood, and unify groups of lines. Exact rhyme, so you want to write this down because we're going to be looking at both examples of this. Exact rhyme, two or more words that have identical sounds in their final stressed syllables, as one and begun. Notice the sound is the same, right? One, begun, that's exact rhyme, right? Tool, fool, that's an exact rhyme, yes? But then we have what's called, and you want this in your notes, slant rhyme. Slant rhyme. It's not exact, you might write it as close. It's close or near rhyme, right? In slant rhyme, the final sounds are similar, but not identical, as in one stone. One stone. Now you gotta be honest, that's not an exact rhyme. One stone, it's not an exact rhyme, but it's kind of close. And Emily Dickinson loves this kind of stuff. She'll do it all the time in her poetry. Another thing that's not even mentioned here that we'll talk about is word order. She likes to invert things. So, for example, instead of saying the blue house, she'll sometimes say the house blue. And in the process of doing that, she's going to change your way of reading for a split second. And you go, the house blue? Oh, you mean the blue house. I got it. See how that works? To make your mind have to try to appreciate the game that she's playing. And now let's write that down, the word game. I love to teach Emily Dickinson this way. You are playing a game with her. Okay? A game where you sit down to try to figure out. That's the whole point of This Is My Letter to the World. It's a game. It's a game that she's playing with you, where she invites you to come along for the ride, and maybe you'll get it right away, and maybe you won't get it right away. But don't give up so easy, because the rewards will be great. Now, one of the poems that I love to teach of Emily Dickinson's is back on this sheet of paper. And as I finish my introduction to Dickinson, I'll go to this one. Let's take a look at this poem really quickly. And then we'll investigate not only Dickinson as poet of form, but also content. This ability for her to make observations in really simple language. Okay? Again, this poem is not in your anthology, but it's one that my students over the years have loved so much that I love to teach it. Take a look at this one. Success is counted sweetest. I'm on the second poem now on your handout. Okay? And again, you'll want to have in front of you this handout, and you're going to want to have your writing utensil. Obviously, we'll begin to annotate right there on the page, okay? Look at it with me and read it with me. Success is counted sweetest by those who ne'er succeed. To comprehend a nectar requires sorest need. Not one of all the purple hosts who took the flag today can tell the definition so clear of victory as he defeated dying, on whose forbidden ear the distant strains of triumph burst agonized and clear. Now again, you would maybe make the mistake of, dude, look how short it is. We'll be done with this annotation in what? 2 minutes, no problem. Almost all the words, with the exception of maybe nectar and the use of the word comprehend, all the words are easy vocab words. Not like it's hard to, you know, the words. And yet, I've had students that say, dude, you might as well stand up in front of us and go like this, because that's about all that meant to me when you were reading that poem to me. Which is fun, because like I said, it's a game. Some of you are going to say, by the time I'm finished with these little sets, I'm not making this up, some of you will say, this is the coolest poem I've ever read. I promise you, I have students say this every year. This is the coolest poem I have ever, absolutely ever read. But I did not understand it at all at first. Let's take a look. It's actually a very simple poem. It's a poem of two parts. It is a poetic essay. Now, in essay writing, we always have a thesis, right? We know that from our work, don't we? Always have a thesis, and we always have our points of validation. Dickinson is going to provide her thesis in the very first line. Success is counted sweetest by those who ne'er succeed. What does that mean? Can you try to take that and put that in your own words? Success is counted sweetest. Try and write it down right now. See if you can do this. Engage in the activity of game playing with Emily Dickinson. It's fun to do it. Try and put it in your own words. Success is counted sweetest by those who ne'er succeed. Now this is just pure paradox. Are you ready for this? You want to know who understands about winning success? Not winners. Not winners. Not the guys after the game going, we're number one. No. She is going to say, you want to know who knows about winning? It's losers. Those are the ones that know about winning. Winners don't know about winning. They got no clue what winning means. Losers, they know all about winning. What? See, already I can see on some of your face, you're like, dude, that don't make no sense. That's what we call paradox. Losers are the real understanders of winners and winning. Not winners, losers. Now that's her thesis. And if you write down on your paper, losers understand winning, not winners, you've got the first two lines. Success is counted sweetest by those who ne'er. Ne'er means never. Never succeed. You want to find somebody that really understands winning? Find somebody that loses all the time. Find somebody that never seems to get it right. Find somebody that screws it up all the time. Find that person, and that person will understand all about winning. not winners, not people, we're number one, we're, no, not those guys. Find the people who don't know about that. They'll tell you all about what it means to be a winner, a success. Now, she's going to give you this strange paradoxical thesis that losers are actually the only winners. And she's going to validate it with two interesting word pictures that we'll look at now. And once we work through the language, you'll go, oh, I totally get it. Look at the first one. It's very simple. To comprehend a nectar requires sorest need. Now, I for years have been saying that we should have you be able to write in your books what we call internal annotation. Of course, when we're doing this level 1, 2, A, 2B, 3, A, 3B off the page, we call that external annotations, yes? But it would be so much easier if you could have right there in your hand, your pen, and you could write in your book as you go. So for example, if you could write right now, you would circle the word comprehend, and you would circle the word nectar, because you would say to yourself, I know Dickinson's telling me something here, but the language is getting in my way a little bit. To comprehend, now if you're reading, for example, and you comprehend, do you get it or do you not get it? If you comprehend, you get it, right? To comprehend means to appreciate. Write that down. To comprehend means to appreciate. To comprehend means to get it. Oh, I get it. I get it. Like, or I appreciate it, or I understand it, or I respect it. That's what we mean by comprehend. Nectar here simply means water, a drink, a drink. Okay? Now see, already I can tell some of you are starting to, oh, wait a second. See, think about this for a moment. Watch this. There's two kinds of can I go get a drink. Mr. McGee, can I go get a drink? Two kinds. One, I just need to get out 303 for a few minutes. Can I go get a drink?
Yeah.
Up, I go down the hall, get a drink, down back. That's one kind of drink. But what if you were to spend almost 3 days locked in some room without water? And all of a sudden, right at the last seconds, you think you hear a voice outside that room and you go, hey. And all of a sudden somebody's like, dude, there's something. They open the door. And you go, can I get a drink? Ah, that's a whole different can I get a drink. Would you agree with me? What's the difference between the two? Go ahead, write it down. What's the difference between the two? Dude, I need to go get a drink and go up 3 days without water. You're almost dead. Can I have a little water? How's that water going to taste on your mouth, on your tongue? Which person, the one, dude, can I just go get a drink? Or, I got to have something. Which one understands the value of water? Which one comprehends the value of nectar? It's the people who don't have it, water, who really appreciate water. Not the people who get it all the time. It's the people who don't have it, who really appreciate it. Success is counted sweetest by those who ne'er succeed. To comprehend the nectar requires sorest need. Got me? Notice the exact rhyme of need, succeed. Correct? Right? But now she's going to give us a second word picture, which will only make sense when you recognize the date you wrote down on your paper. 1850. What's significant in American history when we start talking about 1850? Well, of course, you know it, don't you? The great American Civil War happened. Dickinson is going to use a very interesting word picture. It's a word picture, though, that only makes sense once I explain it to you. Are you ready for this? By the way, you can drop your pens now. You ain't going to need to write this down. I guarantee you will not forget this. And some of you will say, dude, he has to be making this up. I'm not making this up. This is how they fought battles in the American Civil War. Both sides, North and South, of course, in the early part of the war, you identified northern soldiers by southern against southern soldiers by the garment that they wore, right? Right? So you've probably seen this. Some of them wore gray, some of them wore blue, depending on whether they were in the North or the Confederacy in the South, correct? Of course, after a few months of wearing the same garment, the colors all were pretty much just black soil. You got me? Right? Okay. But at the very beginning, the idea was that. They all carried a rifle. That rifle had to be loaded with powder. Got me? And you would put then this little ball that would go down inside with some powder. Some of you probably have even seen this. Maybe one or two of you have actually shot a muzzleloader before, okay? And you would have to carry on your pouch a little bit of gunpowder and then a little bit of these balls as well. And you carried this rifle with you. Whatever it was you were going to shoot, you carried it with you. The men would come out into a field. They would all line up in a line. There would be one line here. There would be one line over there. Couldn't be much farther than 30 yards. Had to be close enough to see them. The first line would step up. They would aim at the other line and they would shoot. And then they had to start reloading their firearms. And then the other line would shoot back. And then they would start loading their firearms. Okay? Now right away, of course, there would start to be smoke everywhere. How come? Because you're shooting muzzleloaders and gunpowder creates this big, right? So if you've got several hundred guys or more firing at the same time, very quickly it gets really, really hazy. You're not even sure who's over there anymore. That's why you're so close. And so you keep shooting. And most of the time, you don't even see what you're shooting. You're just shooting. And when you run out of bullets, which happened because these are metal bullets and so they're heavy, so you can't carry hundreds of them. When you ran out of bullets, you had a sword on the tip of your rifle, bayonet, and then you would just run at the other side. Most of the time you couldn't even see. And so, of course, you ran. And then you collided, and then you just started stabbing things and cutting things. Of course, the stories of the American Civil War are tragic. Where, for example, friendly fire, guys died all the time. You killed your own buddy because you were so disoriented. You didn't even know where you were. The fear, the smoke. Of course, there were tragic stories of brothers killing brothers, fathers killing sons. These stories out of the Civil War break your heart. What to do? The answer is a flag.
A flag?
A flag. You put a flag on a flagpole and it went way up high in the air. And somebody stood and held that thing. Got me? The objective of the battle was to capture the flag. Some of you will say, dude, I played a game when I was a kid called Capture the Flag. You never understood the origin of the game, did you? The guy who held the flag with two hands did not shoot a rifle. You knew the battle was over when you couldn't see the flag of the other guys. When the flag was captured, that meant the battle was over. Who got shot at first? See how that works? So you got one guy holding this flag. The other side, who are they going to shoot at? Yeah, because once the flag falls, bam, we're the winners. But as soon as the guy gets shot and the flag falls, somebody has to drop his rifle, pick up the flag, bam. Do you got me? Right? Over and over again, the person who holds up the flag is the one most likely to get jacked. When nobody wants to pick up the flag anymore, that means the other side has won. And the flag has been captured. Of course, it was the height of cowardice to turn and run away with the flag. Yes? So the flag would be always in the front. And then when you're fighting with all this smoke, you could look up and see. And is our flag still up? Yeah, our flag's still up. We're still fighting. Oh, our flag? Where's our flag? Oh, we're lost. It's over. And then guys would turn and start running a lot of times. If they couldn't see their flag, they would turn and start running. You're probably familiar that in the Second World War, in one of the most famous iconic moments in photographs, and of course today, if you go to D.C., you will see this monument where you will see some Marines who are trying to push the flag up. Some of you maybe wonder, dude, what is up with that? Why does it take that many guys to hold the flag up? We're making an important statement, aren't we? What does that mean when all those guys are pushing that flag up? They will not let that flag what? Because the minute that flag falls, done. And then what happens? Well, the winners, they get to get the flag. Then they can stand and shout, "We're number one, we're number one." Of course, there are going to be a whole lot of people on the other side, the losers, who are going to be laying there, half dead, dead, right? Waiting to die. And they're going to hear what? They're going to hear the chants of what? "We're number one, we're number," right? Not one. See, I'm now back to my poem. Funny thing, how when you learn just a little bit of background, all of a sudden the text starts to mean so much more. Success is counted sweetest by those who ne'er succeed. To comprehend a nectar requires sorest need. Dude, can I have a drink? Not one, take a look at the poem, now you're reading with me. Not one of all the purple host who took the flag today, winner or loser, write it on your paper. If they took the flag, what are they, winner or loser? They took the flag. See, I've had students that say, the next time I'm at a ball game and they tell me they want me to stand up and look at a flag while they do that thing called the national anthem, now I understand. Right. That flag represents all of the people who died so that flag would get What's that mean to be the first guy to volunteer? You know, like, see, we're in this room. Okay, we're about to do this thing. Okay, you're gonna hold the flag. What's that code language for? What's that mean when we go, "You're gonna hold the flag"? What's that mean? Right, you're the first one that's gonna get jacked. Because all those guys are gonna point their bullets right at you. But the minute you drop the flag, someone's gonna have to drop their rifle and pick up the flag. Are you ready for this? Let's go, let's go. What kind of courage does that take? That's what you're referencing when the national anthem is played. Why put your hand over your heart? Well, what's the fastest way to jack somebody? Either put a bullet in their head or in their chest. Right? That heart, of course, is a sign of respect for all the people who tried to hold that flag up. Notice here, not one of all the purple host who took the flag today, the winners, right? Not one of all the purple hosts who took the flag today can tell the definition so clear of victory. Those guys who got the flag, they don't know about victory. We're number one. They're standing there with the flag. We're number one. Yay, we won, we won. No. They don't know about victory. As he defeated, dying, whose forbidden ear the distant strains of triumph burst, agonized, clear. Whoa. So there you are. Your flag got captured. You're lying there in the mud. Your face in the mud. You're dying. And the last thing you hear is the chant, "We're number one. We're number one." Dickinson says, you, the loser, are the one that really understands winning. You get it. Because you don't have it. You really understand. Now, a number of years ago, I'd lectured this poem. That year, Worland High School had a tremendously gifted basketball team on the guy's side. Unbelievable. And all year long, everybody followed this team because it was pretty obvious this team was going to the state playoffs. Everybody kind of had a sense of it. Maybe this was the year finally that the boys would win a championship because it had been so long. Man, this was a stellar team. The only problem was, in the state, there was one other team in the class who was also stellar, and they came from the town down the road, pal. And what do you know? Regional tournament happens there in Powell. Everybody leaves this town to go down to Powell. And by the time I got there, there were people already standing outside of the foyer. Nobody could get a seat inside of the old Powell gym. Both bands entirely were there on two different sides of the gym floor, and there's supposed to be this rule that they have, which is kind of like unwritten, that you're not supposed to play your fight songs at the same time. And in timeouts, both bands start playing at the same time. The screaming was so unbelievably loud in this gym that I was standing next to my pal and I screamed and he could not hear a word I was saying. I got no reading done this game, okay? As I like to do when I go to these games. None. Everyone stood the entire game. And Powell was exceptionally gifted as well, a brilliant team as well. When they had played here in Worland, it had gone to an overtime, and Worland had won. When we had played in Powell, it had gone to an overtime, and in overtime, Powell had won in a last-second shot. And so it surprised nobody that by the end of this game, we were in overtime. And Worland calls timeout with, like, I think it was 7 seconds left, and Worland is down by 1 point. And one of the players came in the next day, and he said, the coach was just like screaming, and none of us could hear a word. Nobody could hear anything. And so we go out onto the floor, and it was like out of a movie. It was phenomenal, out of a movie. And the ball gets passed in, and the Worland kid dribbles, and he launches the shot. And I swear the ball hit the rim like 17 times, bouncing, 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 rolling, bouncing, as time runs out, and the ball drops in. And it was the weirdest thing to watch. I'm standing there and I watch this. 1 minute, you can see a gym floor. The next minute, there is no gym floor. It's completely gone. Several of the Powell kids just collapse. They just fall over like, no way, we just lost. And the entire floor just collapses. And all of the Worland fans just immediately are out onto the floor. You cannot see the gym floor anymore, right? It's just one of these exciting moments. One of those kids playing on that team was my student. And he came in on Monday, right? Because this had happened Saturday night. And he came in on Monday and he said, yeah, of course, had a big smile on his face. He goes, were you there? I was like, oh, yeah, yeah. And he said, dude, the funniest thing happened to me. And I was like, yeah, I know you won. He goes, no, not that. He goes, after the game. He said, you know, in the old Powell gym, the winners or the visitors' locker room and the home locker room were on the same side. And there was a common wall, a cement wall in between them. So on one side of the wall, you got the visitor's locker room. On the other side of the wall, you've got the Powell locker room. And he said, we're in the locker room after the game. Obviously, you can imagine what it was like in there, right? To win this thing, to be able to win, you know, and beat your adversary that way. And he goes, it was so awesome. We were like jumping around. We're number one. We were screaming and everything. And then he said, all of a sudden, it hit me, that poem that you taught me. And I was like, what are you talking about? You know, that stupid Emily Dickinson poem about winners are not really, losers are really winners. Remember that poem? I said, success is counted sweetest by those who never succeed. Yeah, that one. He said, here's the weirdest thing. He goes, I was sitting there and all of a sudden it hit me that on the other side of that wall, those Powell guys are sitting there. And it has to be dead silent in that locker room. Right? And because it's only a brick wall, you know that they're hearing our screaming on the other side of the wall. We're number one. And he said, all of a sudden it hit me, that poem. That it's not winners who really appreciate winning, it's the people who don't get the win, it's the losers who really appreciate, right? And he said, for a split second, the thought occurred to me that if that ball had dropped out of the rim, right, in the end of overtime, everything would have been reversed. And we would have been sitting in the, right, in the locker room like, and we would have been hearing the Powell kids jumping up and down, we're number one, right? And he said, and for a split second, I actually felt sorry for those guys in that other locker room. Just for a split second, he said. And then I jumped up and started screaming all over again, we're number one. Yes. In other words, they got what they deserved. They got to lose. Success is counted sweetest by those who never succeed. Think about this for a moment. Now, this is a fascinating question. Have you really learned the most important stuff in your life? Not from victory, not from winning, not from when you were great, but from when you were a loser, when you were a failure. Let's do a quick annotation now of this text, right? Think about really quickly a time when you actually learned something, you were successful, because you were a failure. You learned something when you were a loser. You learned something when it didn't work out. Instead of winning, instead of getting what you wanted, you didn't get what you wanted. And it really torqued you up. It really hurt you. It made you angry. It made you sad. And yet now, looking back, you go, wow, that was really important. That was really important that I lost. That was really important that it happened that way. Some of you will say, I guess it's true. You know, if you end up in a summer school class getting lectured on Emily Dickinson, that's probably because you didn't pass English.
English class. That's called looser. And now you're getting information. That's called winner. Life is interesting like this, Dickinson says. Some of the most important stuff that will happen in your life will happen not because you were successful, but because you were a loser. You were a failure. It was when you screwed up that you actually learn about winning, about succeeding, about how hard it is to succeed. Success is counted sweetest by those who ne'er succeed. To comprehend a nectar requires sore sleep. Not one of all the purple hosts who took the flag today can tell the definition so clear of victory as he defeated, dying on whose forbidden ear the distant strains of triumph burst, agonized and clear. And then finally, the punctuation at the end. Notice both of these poems end with what? Funny, huh? A woman who was so quiet that when she talked, you could barely hear her, likes to finish her poetry with exclamation marks a lot of times. In other words, learn how to see life a little bit differently, and you will learn how to learn from life. It is going to be often the unsuccessful who finally get it. Success is good, but failure is sometimes more important. We're not going to say that we will. Yay, I hope I'm a loser and I try. No. But I've coached a lot of ball players that say some of the most important stuff I ever learned was not in the seasons when I was victorious. It was in the seasons when I struggled, when things didn't go very well, when we had to figure stuff out, right? Or, for example, the student who said, I came from a loser family. Everything about my family was totally jacked up. And the obvious question is, can you learn from that experience? And when you're a mom or a dad, can you somehow do it a little better? See, you can use failure to become better if you're willing to try. An introduction to Emily Dickinson. So now we'll be ready to approach a few of Emily Dickinson's poems. Yes? Thank you.